Well, there's been highs and lows this week. Over the weekend, this morning on Pure West Radio Pembrokeshire, Daniel was advertising the prayer breakfast, which is on the 7th of November at 10 o'clock in the morning. Andrew Ollerton is speaking at it, and there's lots of other people taking part. And then Robin, on the same programme, was giving a talk on an interview on Walk Through the Bible. So they were the highs of today anyway, but yesterday there was a low, wasn't there? Wales lost, England won. But never mind, there's another year to come for next year when they might win the Six Nations. So whatever way you've come this morning to worship God, we open our hearts to the Lord Jesus, don't we? Today also is All Saints Day. And the word for saint in the Bible is hagios, which means the Holy One. And that's a wonderful thing because it's an expression of the living Lord Jesus Christ in the power of the Holy Spirit. Hagios, the Holy Ones. So let's open our hearts to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank and praise you that as believers called out from the world and to live for you, we can meet together in this service this morning. We thank you that you call us to live holy lives. We thank you for the freedom in Christ through the love and power of the Holy Spirit. And in our service this morning, may we know the presence of the Lord Jesus in the power of his Holy Spirit on Zoom and on telephone. Be with us, Lord, as you promised to be, and speak deep into our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Now, Mervyn and Stephanie are going to lead us in our worship, and following that, Brian is going to lead us in prayer. Thanks, Mervyn, Steph, and Brian afterwards.
Thanks, John.
Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Well, we've had stormy weather, haven't we, over these last few days? To go with the stormy times that we're living in, I feel. These are difficult days, aren't they? And I don't know about you, but I found this second lockdown really wearing and tiring. But it's a good opportunity to fill our hearts with truth. And that's what I've been doing this week, is pondering some well-loved verses. And I'm going to read them to you this morning. And I pray that God, through his Holy Spirit, will touch his heart, your heart, with his word. Psalm 46, verse 1. God is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in trouble. Isaiah 41, verse 10. So do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. And Isaiah 26, verses 3 and 4, you will keep in perfect peace those whose minds are steadfast because they trust in you. Trust in the Lord forever. For the Lord himself is the rock eternal. And it's to the Lord we come this morning with our worship and our praise. To the one who alone is our rock and our hope and our salvation. I'm going to sing two songs this morning, and I pray that you'll sing along with me as we worship God together.
Jesus' name. When
Support me in the whirling flood. When all around my soul gives way, He then is all my strength and stay. He then is all my hope and stay. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of lords. When He shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in Him be found, dressed in His righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. Shall we come to the Lord in prayer? Let's pray. Father, thank You that You are the rock eternal. Thank You, Lord Jesus, that our hope is in You and in You alone. And in these difficult, stormy days, Lord, we hold fast to You, and we know that You're holding fast to us, that You are our strength and our help and our enabler. And Lord, thank You that Yours is the name that is above every other name. You are the King of kings and Lord of all. Lord, thank You that You are the one who stilled the storm, but also who walked on the stormy seas. You hold all things together by Your mighty power. And Lord, we worship You this morning, and we thank You for Your love and Your grace, Your mercy that You pour into our lives day by day. We thank You that You are our ever-present help, our refuge and our shelter. Lord, thank You that Your name is a strong tower and the righteous run to it and are safe. And we praise You, Jesus, in Your precious name. Amen.
We'll be at home
war will be over. Soon we will meet our Saviour face to face, and every burden will be lifted in His presence. Every trophy will be laid down at His feet. There is a name that reigns above all other, Jesus Christ, the King above all kings. And all our worship will belong to You forever. Holy, holy, for all eternity. Yours is the name that reigns above all other, Jesus Christ, the King above all kings. Jesus Christ, the King above all kings. And it's Him that we worship. Thank you.
On this day, All Saints Day, it's a traditional day when we remember the great luminaries, the of faith of past years, you know, the people of great faith, men and women who've demonstrated in their lives such a dedication to serving God and serving the Christian community. But the definition of saints goes far greater than that. We, as brothers and sisters of Christ, are considered saints. It's part of our heritage. We are the saints of God today. And we pray that through our lives, we may dedicate all we do, think or say to our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ. And that activity, it just brings us alive in His presence as His saints. So shall we pray? Heavenly Father, we thank You for Your powerful word that is sharper than any two-edged sword. It is Your word that commands and encourages to pray. And we pray that the authority You give us by Your Holy Spirit and in the name of Jesus Christ for the church, our Christian community, our nation and the world, we may open our hearts, our minds, in our prayers to You, our Father God. It's Your word that tells us if we draw near to You, You will draw near to us. Father, be present and active in our petitions and prayers today as Your saints. Father, thank You that You have intimate knowledge of each one of us individually. Help us to be effective and constant in prayer as we pray for our nation, for the members of the assemblies in Wales and Northern Ireland, for those who govern Scotland and those in Westminster. Father, will You guide and encourage all politicians who serve the people? Will You guide them with Your wisdom as they try to navigate the ever-changing problems caused by the COVID pandemic? May they deal with the economic pressures placed on businesses and individuals with fairness and compassion. So, Father, we pray that You will uphold the Christians in government, that they may reflect the love and grace of Christ and be a bright light in the sometimes dark corridors of power. We pray for businesses as they struggle to cope with closure or restricted sales. Father, be with all those who are struggling financially and those facing redundancy and unemployment. And as restrictions are reimposed here in Wales and in England from next Thursday, we pray that You will be with all those who are troubled by anxiety and fear, all those who are shielding and feeling vulnerable. Grant them Your peace. Help us all to adjust to what is now the new normal. And may we place our confidence and trust in You alone. Father God, it must grieve you to see the world in the state that it is, with disease running rampant, religious and ethnic, political violence at an all-time high, with corruption and bloody power struggles in many nations, affecting and costing the lives of ordinary peace-loving people. We pray that your graceful peace, loving presence, may be once again evident across the world. We pray especially for the people of Nigeria, as peaceful protests continue to be met with extreme use of force. And Lord, there are many places in this fallen world living without true freedom and in poverty and violence. Lord, you know them all. Give us the will to pray, help and support as far as we are able. O Lord, as we wait in a world of turmoil for an end to sickness and anxiety, the face masks and lockdowns, the loneliness and job losses, Lord, help us to keep our eyes fixed on you. Help us to be strong and take heart as we wait for you to deliver us. And Lord, give us the grace to look beyond ourselves and remember others in far more difficult situations, especially our brothers and sisters in contexts of persecution or great poverty, where coronavirus has been yet one more hardship to add to what they already bear so patiently. Father, bless them and provide for them. This we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. And healing, Lord, for the NHS, for nursing and care homes and all who work in the community to support the disabled and the vulnerable. Thank you for all who help to bring healing to body and soul, those who work to bring comfort and relief to mind and emotions. And Father, we thank you for those in our fellowship who serve you in the NHS and in the community, for Rhiannon and Saran, for Bonnie and for Viv and Roz, for Heather and for Rob in his work with Saline Solution. We pray for Tim and Louise and Pip, who bring the gentleness and understanding of gracious care to others in the community. May they all serve you with compassion and gentleness as your saints. We thank you for all key workers and all those who have kept the infrastructure of our country going through these difficult days. We especially pray for guidance and for those in the scientific community working to produce vaccines and leading trials to find an effective treatment that will enable life to return to normality. Bless the work of their hands and make them fruitful. We pray for those that we know who are struggling with long-term sickness and disease, those whose treatments have been delayed, for those who are housebound or coping with problems of old age. Lord Jesus, we pray for wholeness and healing of body, soul, and spirit. And we know, Father God, that you are the God of all comfort. Be gracious to all those who mourn the loss of loved ones. Be their strength and hope for the future. We offer our prayers to you for the families and friends of those who have lost lives in the earthquake in Turkey and Greece. We offer our prayers to you for all those families who have lost loved ones in the COVID pandemic. We also bring to you those desperate migrants and refugees as they come to terms with the loss of loved ones, paying the ultimate price in risking everything to get to Britain across the Channel. Father, grant all who deal with the death of loved ones the grace of your compassion and peace to come to terms with loss. We pray for all those mourning the loss of livelihoods, of health and strength, and for all those facing major changes in working practices or in retirement. We ask that you will come close to each one of them. May they seek your face and your unfailing love. Father, we pray for those we love who don't know you. Members of our families, our friends, our children. Thank you that you are always at work. So will you soften their hearts and give them opportunities to meet with you as we have met with you. Inspire, enable us to speak for you when the opportunity arises. Father, you have given us good news. Help us to share it. We want to witness to your love, to share with others what you have done for us, and to reflect something of your love through the people we are. Give us discernment for when we speak, when to act, and when to be still, leaving things in your hands. We pray for parents and children at home in half-term lockdown, and those unsure whether they will be able to return to high school, college, or university. Be with them in a special way that it may indeed be a time of building stronger family relationships, a time of relaxation, fun, and laughter. We especially ask you to help those families where relationships are strained, those on limited incomes, and in one-parent families. And Father, as we look to the future, we ask you to be with John, Jerry, Dan and Sarah and the leadership team as they prepare to find the right time to open the doors of the church again and to restart the children's and young people's work in a safe way. Lord, may your will and timing, as ever, govern their decisions. How great is the love the Father has lavished upon us that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are. So thank you, Heavenly Father, that we can know the security of being in a loving relationship with you. And thank you, Lord Jesus, that as many people look to the future with deep concerns to those who have received you as Lord and Saviour, that they can look to a future that is secure in your love. And to an eternity in your precious presence. And shall we say together the Lord's Prayer in contemporary language? Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Thanks, Brian. And Cherry is going to come and read God's word to us now. Thank you, Cherry.
Steve did a brilliant job last week reading Nehemiah chapter 3. The great long list of unfamiliar names of all the people who started to rebuild the walls of Jerusalem. I'm very glad I'm reading Nehemiah chapter 4. So here we go. The story continues. Nehemiah chapter 4. When Sanballat heard that we were rebuilding the wall, he became angry and was greatly incensed. He ridiculed the Jews, and in the presence of his associates and the army of Samaria, he said, "What are these feeble Jews doing? Will they restore their wall? Will they offer sacrifices? Will they finish in a day? Can they bring these stones back to life from those heaps of rubble, burned as they are?" Tobiah the Ammonite, who was at his side, said, "What are they building? If even a fox climbed up on it, he would break down their wall of stones." Hear us, O God, for we are despised. Turn their insults back on their own heads. Give them over as plunder in a land of captivity. Do not cover up their guilt or blot out their sins from your sight, for they have thrown insults in the face of the builders. So we rebuilt the wall till all of it had reached half its height, for the people worked with all their heart. And when Sanballat, Tobiah, the Arabs, the Ammonites, and the men of Ashdod heard that the repairs to Jerusalem's walls had gone ahead and that the gaps were being closed, they were very angry. They all plotted together to come and fight against Jerusalem and stir up trouble against it. But we prayed to our God and posted a guard day and night to meet this threat. Meanwhile, the people in Judah said, "The strength of the laborers is giving out, and there is so much rubble that we cannot rebuild the wall." Also, our enemies said, "Before they know it or see us, we will be right there among them and will kill them and put an end to the work." Then the Jews who lived near came, told us 10 times over, "Whenever you turn, they will attack us." Therefore, I stationed some of the people behind the lowest points of the wall at the exposed places, posting them by families with their swords, spears, and bows. After I looked things over, I stood up and said to the nobles, the officials, and the rest of the people, "Don't be afraid of them. Remember, the Lord who is great and awesome, and fight for your brothers, your sons and your daughters, your wives and your homes." When our enemies heard that we were aware of their plot and that God had frustrated it, we all returned to the wall, each to his own work. From that day on, half of my men did the work, while the other half were equipped with spears, shields and bows and armor. The officers posted themselves behind all the people of Judah who were building the wall. Those who carried materials did their work with one hand and held a weapon in the other. And each of the builders wore his sword at his side as he worked. But the man who sounded the trumpet stayed with me. Then I said to the nobles, the officials, and the rest of the people, "The work is extensive and spread out, and we are widely separated from each other along the wall. Whenever you hear the sound of the trumpet, join us there. Our God will fight for us." So we continued the work, with half the men holding spears from the first light of dawn till the stars came out. At that time, I also said to the people, "Have every man and his helper stay inside Jerusalem at night, so that they can serve as guards by night and workmen by day. Neither I, nor my brothers, nor the men, nor the guards with me took off our clothes. Each had his weapon, even when he went for water." Thank you.
Thanks so much, Cherry. It comes alive, doesn't it, God's word, when it's read to us. We read it ourselves, but when someone else reads it, it comes to life in a new way. And I'd encourage you over this time to go back over Nehemiah 1, 2, 3 and 4. Read it in your own quiet times. It's a fantastic story. Okay, Nehemiah 3 is a bit tricky, but it's a wonderful story, isn't it, that unfolds before us. And it's great to get to this point today. It almost reads a bit like an episode of Lord of the Rings, doesn't it, with the opposition and the danger and the threat. We almost feel what they must have felt. So we're going to watch the Lego video now that will hopefully give us another perspective on the story, and then we're going to come to God's word together. So let me just share this video.
Work on the Great Wall of Jerusalem. Many workers were gathered and they labored both day and night. The king had given Nehemiah permission to build, but there were some who opposed the work. Sanballat and Tobiah gathered together Arabs, Amorites, Ashdodites, and wealthy Samaritans.
"What are these feeble Jews doing? Can we allow them to rebuild Jerusalem?
If a fox jumped on what they're building, it would break."
Sanballat and Tobiah decided to cause a disturbance in Jerusalem.
Do not be afraid of them. Remember the Lord and fight for your families. Stay focused.
From then on, half the men carried on the work while the other half stood guard. Everyone kept their weapons close at hand.
I wonder if you've ever wondered why it is when you can do the right thing, you can pray about something, you can stop doing what you wanted to do, what God wants you to do instead. And instead of things going the way you planned, instead of things getting better, actually sometimes things get worse. Why is that? Why is it easier to tear something down than it is to build something up? Why is it easier to live our own way than it is to live God's way? Why is it that sometimes things seem to get worse when we've prayed and we've acted in the right way and we do believe that we're following Jesus in the right way? Well, the Bible teaches us that one of the reasons why is that we have an enemy. We have an enemy who hates God, God's people, and everything that God stands for. He hates the way God loves to bring beauty out of ashes. He hates the way God loves to restore things that are broken. He hates the way God loves to rebuild what has once been rubble in our lives. And we see that in this passage. Behind all enemies of God's people is the enemy. So in chapter 4, verse 1, we read, "When Sanballat heard that we were rebuilding the wall, he became angry and was greatly incensed. He ridiculed the Jews." As soon as the enemy hears that things are starting to go well, that things are starting to progress, that God's plan is beginning to unfold, he fights against it. And that is true in our lives today. As soon as the enemy sees God beginning to do something in your life, as soon as he sees you leave some sin behind or grow to know Jesus better, he comes and he's incensed and he tries to fight against us. And this chapter is a wonderful encouragement for us this morning, because in it we get to see the enemy show his hand. When I was younger, I loved playing Monopoly. I still love playing Monopoly, but I'm banned these days. But we used to play Monopoly as kids. And I had a very, very good strategy that meant I would win pretty much 99 times out of 100. And it was this. I would buy the blue and the pink as fast as I possibly could. I would beg, borrow or steal or trade, do whatever I could to get those properties. And then I would spend everything I had and more in order to put hotels on them first. So when my sisters came round, before they were even earning a single cent, I'd be earning thousands and instantly winning the game. And that worked brilliantly for me time and time again until the day my sisters figured out what I was doing. And the day they figured that out, they made this pact between them, unbeknown to me, that no one would trade with me, would sell to me, would help me in any kind of way. And it was infuriating because from that moment on, I was unable to use my strategy. It was completely unpacked before my eyes. I was neutralized and I wasn't able to win. Understanding our enemy's strategy helps us to stand firm in the power of the Holy Spirit. So as I share a little bit about what the enemy is doing this morning, we're not doing that to glorify what he does. We're doing it so, as Paul says, that we're not unaware of his schemes. So we're going to do that to begin with. One strategy the enemy uses, the first thing is this. He tries to make us doubt that rebuilding is possible. When Sanballat comes and begins to spread those rumors about the Jews, he doesn't do it in a blatant way, does he? He doesn't get in Nehemiah's face and begin telling him how useless he is. Instead, he does it very, very subtly. Look with me in verse 2. Sanballat, in the presence of his associates and in the army of Samaria. Sanballat talks to other people about Nehemiah and the Jews. He talks subtly. He gets them to question through rumor and through whisper. And he does that in our lives. The enemy does that in our lives. He might not come in a way we expect. He might not look like that demon that we should avoid. He looks reasonable. He makes sense. He comes through whisper and rumor and ridicule to try and get us to doubt that rebuilding is possible. And first of all, Sanballat asks some questions. And these are questions that the enemy uses in our lives too. The first is this, in verse 2, what are those feeble Jews doing? He gets them to focus on how weak they are. And the enemy will try that in your life. As you seek to leave some sin or temptation behind, as you seek to live for him, he'll try and constantly remind you how weak you are. You know, maybe he'll point to other people, other Christians, and make you think that they're kind of super Christians, you know, the ones that have got it all together, that are really living for Jesus, that are living in the power of the Holy Spirit. And he'll make you think that we're super Christians and then they're kind of feeble Christians. And the reality is, all of us are feeble. All of us are weak. We all need a savior. Jesus doesn't assist us over the finish line. He wakes us up from death and gives us everything we need. And as we've been thinking today, it's All Saints Day. We're not just sinners. We are saints. We're a holy people. So we're not weak. We have the power of the Holy Spirit in our lives today. The enemy will try and tell you that you are weak and that you cannot do this. But he'll also try and focus on the problem. And so the second question that Sanballat asks, the second series of questions is, will they restore their wall? Will they finish in a day? Can they bring the stones back to life from those heaps of rubble burned as they are? And he's basically saying, you are never going to achieve this. This problem is too big. Those stones are too burned. You are never going to be able to do it. It's going to take too long. It's going to be too hard. It's going to be too difficult. And maybe that's something you're struggling with. Even this week, you think, you know, my debts are so massive, I'm never going to pay them off. That problem in my marriage is so big, it's going to take too much effort, too much trouble to try and fix it. That friendship that is broken, I'm never going to see it restored. That person I'm praying for to come and know Jesus, that is impossible. And the enemy will try and tell you that it will never happen and that it's going to be too much hard work. And we've got to resist his lie. That's one of his strategies, to get us to focus on the problem. And having done that, he attacks our confidence in God. So Sanballat asks the question, will they offer sacrifices? He's basically standing there and saying, what are these Jews going to do? Are they seriously going to pray this wall up? And he mocks and he ridicules and he attacks their confidence in God to help them. And he does that in our lives, doesn't he? He'll remind us of those times when we prayed and we didn't get an answer. He'll remind us of those times when we've prayed and God hasn't done what we expected, or it's taken much longer than we thought. Or he'll just try and remind us, you know, if God really loved you, he wouldn't let you go through this. If God really cared for you, this wouldn't be happening. And he'll try and attack the confidence we have in God. And then he tries to undermine our progress. So in verse 3, Tobiah the Ammonite, another guy comes in and he says, what they are building, even a fox climbing up on it would break down their wall of stones. Now, we know from the archaeological record that was patently not true. You know, that the walls of Jerusalem that Nehemiah rebuilt are 9 foot thick. Even if they'd done just a little bit of the wall, no fox was going to destroy what they'd done so far. And the enemy tries to do that in our lives too. He tries to convince us that what has grown in our lives, what has changed, is actually nothing. That we're still in the same place we were 5 years ago. That we've not grown in our relationship with Jesus. That we've not been set free from some things. That we're actually still struggling in those same old ways. And if he can't convince us of that, he'll try and convince us that what God has for us is just a pile of rubble. That it is useless, that it is failing, that it's going to crumble beneath us. And he tries to do that to get us to doubt that rebuilding is possible. And now, if that doesn't work, often what the enemy does is he stops being so subtle about things and he becomes more blatant. And we see that in the passage. Nehemiah prays in verse 6, the wall is rebuilt up to half its height. And then what happens? The enemy comes at them stronger. He becomes more blatant. And so in verse 7 and 8, we see Jerusalem become surrounded. Sanballat comes at them from the north. The Ammonites come at them from the east. The Ashdodites would have come at them from the west. And the Arabs would have come at them from the south. So they're now hemmed in. There's this physical threat all around them that is getting worse, is getting bigger, and is growing. And we see three ways the enemy continues to intensify his attack. The first is through discouragement. So in verse 10, meanwhile, the people in Judah said, the strength of the laborers is giving out, and there is so much rubble that we cannot rebuild the wall. When we are tired, when we're weary, when things have taken longer than we expect, that's when we're most likely to face discouragement in our lives. And the enemy will try and use that. He'll try and use other people's discouragement to discourage us. And then he uses fear, verse 11. Also, our enemies said, before they know it or see us, we'll be right there among them and we'll kill them and put an end to their work. So the enemy's making this massive boast that he's powerful, that he's everywhere, and that he can do whatever he likes. And sometimes, I don't know about you, when I watch the news or when I see the state of the world, it's easy to give in to fear, isn't it? To think, gosh, isn't the world so much more evil now than it ever has been? I don't believe that's true, by the way. But I think sometimes we can feel that way. We can feel all these pressures from every side, all the terrorist attacks and the viruses and the evil that is so prevalent. And we think, gosh, maybe, just maybe, that is getting the upper hand at the moment. We begin to fear. And the third thing that we can do is we begin to despair. And in verse 12, the Jews who lived near them came and told us 10 times over, a repeated phrase that was obviously so common, it was like a catchphrase. Wherever you turn, they'll attack us. Wherever you turn, they'll attack us. Wherever you turn, they'll attack us. It had become so ingrained, it was something they were saying to each other on a regular basis. And the enemy wants us to get to that place of despair, of thinking that there is no hope, that he has won, that we're never going to see those walls rebuilt. We'll never be free from sin. We'll never see that relationship restored. We'll never see that person come to faith. We'll never grow to know Jesus better, that life is completely hopeless. That's his strategy. He wants us to doubt. He wants us to be discouraged. He wants to make us fear, and he wants to leave us in despair. But now we know his strategy. We can stand firm in the power of the Holy Spirit. Because we can respond. Now we feel hemmed in on every side. When the enemy comes at us in one of those ways, there are two really simple things we can do to respond. And Nehemiah does them. They're summed up in verse 9. I love this verse. You see this pattern all the way through Nehemiah. It says this, but we prayed to our God and we posted a guard. So Nehemiah prays and he acts. He prays and he acts. And throughout the story, we've seen that, haven't we? Nehemiah doesn't just pray and wait for God to do it, but he doesn't act without first praying and constantly seeking what God is doing. He prays and he acts. So we read his prayer in verse 4. He kind of jumps out of narrating the narrative to tell us his prayer. I just love that. It says this, hear us, our God, for we are despised. Turn their insults back on their own heads. Give them over as plunder in a land of captivity. Do not cover up their guilt or blot out their sins from your sight, for they've thrown insults in the face of the builders. Now that's an honest prayer, isn't it? That's a real prayer. That's not a nicey nice Christian prayer that we often pray. That is a prayer from the heart. Nehemiah is not covering up how he's feeling. He's being real and he's being honest with God. And one way we can fight against the enemy and his schemes is not by harboring bitterness or resentment or anger or pain in our hearts and presenting God with a sanitized prayer. It's just by being real with him, by being honest with him. He's big enough to take it. If you're in a place where you're feeling discouraged this morning, tell the Lord about it. Come to him, open your heart to him and say, God, this sucks right now. I am in a mess. I desperately need your help. I'm angry that this has happened. I'm frustrated that I'm in this place. Please, will you help me? We can come to God and give him our anger and our hurt and our frustration, knowing he's big enough to take it. Nehemiah prays, and as he does that, he's trusting that God would act justly. He knows he doesn't need to try and get a vengeance on Sanballat or Tobiah or the Ashdodites or the Ammonites or any other ites that are out there. He knows he can trust that God will act justly in response to his prayer. And because of that, he encourages the people to do the same. So come with me to verse 14. He says this to them, "Don't be afraid of them. Remember the Lord who is great and awesome, and fight for your families." He encourages them not to give in to fear, but to remember their great and awesome God. And those two words would have reminded the Israelites of the God who had acted in history to save them. The great and awesome deeds of their God were the way he'd led them out of slavery in Egypt, the way he'd given them victory over their enemies. Remember, the Exodus was not just about them being set free. It was also the fact the entire Egyptian army was destroyed. They got victory over their enemies as they passed through the water. And Nehemiah knew that reminding them of that would give them peace in the present and hope for the future. And as we remember the God who has acted in the past, it gives us peace in the present right now. And it gives us wonderful, glorious hope for the future. Because that same great and awesome God who set his people free from slavery in Egypt is the very same God who sets us free from our slavery to sin, from the power of darkness that has got such a grip on us we can do nothing to save ourselves, and who gives us the victory through Jesus. Jesus died on the cross and he rose again. And in doing that, he defeated the powers of darkness, of sin, of death and hell and Satan, not just once, but for all time. Now that's something the enemy will never let on. That's something he'll never suggest. For all his bluster and his boasting, for all the havoc he wreaks in our lives, he'll never let on to you for a second that he's actually been defeated. Jesus Christ has got the victory. He's risen, he's ascended, he's glorious, he's raising over all. And there is no power on heaven and earth that can stop him. Isn't that a wonderful, glorious good news we have this morning? That Jesus has got the victory. And so we can trust him. And so verse 14 is for you. It's for us this morning. Don't be afraid of them. Remember the Lord who is great and awesome. You know, kids, you're going back to school this week. That's a really tough place to be. There are people there who will try and tell you, don't trust Jesus. That's a baby thing. Don't believe in Jesus. It's a load of nonsense. Don't be afraid of them. Remember the Lord. Adults in work, maybe people are trying to say all kinds of things to you about coronavirus and God and how he's not looking after us during this time. Don't be afraid of them. Remember the Lord who's great and awesome. Maybe you've got a non-believing friend or a spouse or a partner who's kind of constantly subtly putting the knife in, you know? Don't be afraid of them. Remember the Lord. We don't fight for victory. We fight from it, don't we? We fight from that wonderful victory that Jesus has won, because we don't just pray, we act. Verse 14 says, don't be afraid of them. Remember the Lord who is great and awesome, and fight. Fight. And we do that in three ways. Really quickly, verse 6, they work with all their heart. There is great power in us faithfully getting up every morning and putting another brick in place. That's what they had to do. In faithfully taking that step to see ourselves removed from temptation or delivered from that sin in our life, or taking that step just to be faithful in our role as a housewife or a mum or as a house father or as a guy in work or as someone who's retired, just faithfully doing what God has called us to do with all our hearts. The enemy cannot stop that when we work in the power of the Holy Spirit. Do not become weary in doing good, Paul says. For at the right time, we will reap a harvest. Why? If we do not give up. And then in verse 9, they watch out. They watch out. We pray to our God and posted a threat day and night. So they're vigilantly looking for when the enemy's going to attack, not just for themselves, but for each other. You know, we read, don't we, about in verse 16 and 17, half are watching while the other are working. And in verse 19, Nehemiah realizes how vulnerable they are. They're all separated. They're spread out. A little bit like us at the moment on lockdown. We're all our individual places spread out across the wall. And that means we're vulnerable. We're vulnerable. I was watching a natural history documentary a little while ago, and I watched in horror as this little elephant was removed from the herd by these predators, gradually just got a little bit further and further and further away. And when she was finally isolated, they attacked. That's what the enemy does. He seeks to isolate us and separate us and then pick us off one by one. So we need to watch out for each other. And for Nehemiah, the way he counters this is in verse 20, it says this: wherever you hear the sound of the trumpet, join us there. Our God will fight for us. Next week at the Pembrokeshire Prayer Breakfast, a trumpet will be blown. It's called the shofar. It's the same trumpet that's mentioned here, the ram's horn trumpet. It was a trumpet that called the Israelites to worship and to prayer and to fight. And one way we watch out for each other is whenever that call is issued to come together to worship, to come together to pray, we're there. We prioritize that as God's people because we know we can't live this life on our own. We need to gather. And when we do that, our God fights for us. God frustrated the enemy's plan, we read. And our God fights for us in the power of the Holy Spirit. So who could you encourage this week? Who could you watch out for? Who could you send that message to? Who could you bless, even though we're on lockdown? Some of us are feeling isolated. We're feeling lonely. As God's people, we can reach out and care for one another. And the final thing is, they wear their weapon. Verse 16 and 17 and 23, wherever they go, they have a sword at their side. And Paul in Ephesians 6 writes about the sword we have. It's a sword we can carry with us wherever we go. It's a sword we can use when we wake up in the morning, when we go to bed at night, when we feel depressed and down and lonely and afraid and tempted. It's the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. We need to be reading it, praying it, singing it, meditating on it, teaching it to our children, sharing it with our grandkids, getting it into our hearts and our souls so that we are ever ready for the enemy's attack. You know, even when they go for water, they're wearing their sword. May that be our call this morning, to always have God's word at hand. So we've got an enemy, haven't we? We've got an enemy. He wants us to doubt. He wants us to become discouraged. He wants us to give in to fear. He wants us to live in despair. But in Jesus Christ, our glorious ascended Saviour, we've got the victory. And so this morning, we can resist him in prayer and in action by working with all our hearts, watching out for his attack and wearing our weapon, the sword of the Spirit. And as we do that, we'll see walls rebuilt in Jesus's wonderful name. As we finish our time together this morning, and before we go into breakout rooms, I just want to pray this verse over you. It's 1 Peter 5, verse 8 to 9. Then we're going to listen to a great song called Whom Shall I Fear? And it's a song that encourages us that there's nothing to fear because God is with us and he's fighting for us. So as we pray together, as we sing that song together, open your heart to the Lord and ask for his strength, for his Holy Spirit to fill you again this morning. 1 Peter 5, verse 8 to 9. Be alert and of sober mind. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. Resist him, standing firm in the faith. And the God of all grace, who called you to his eternal glory in Christ, after you have suffered a little while, will himself restore you and make you strong, firm, and steadfast. To him be the power forever and ever. Amen. Father God, we pray that you would make us strong, firm, and steadfast this morning. In the power of your Holy Spirit, help us to resist the enemy's attack. Lord, we're not unaware of his schemes, and we thank you that in Jesus we have the victory. Help us to live that out in the way we live this week. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's worship God together as we sing this song now. And I'll hand over to John to give us the blessing and the benediction before we go into our breakout rooms.
Well, we thank God this morning for a challenging message and a wonderful service with all the different contributions taking part. We take it into our hearts today, don't we? So let us come before the Lord Jesus in prayer. Our Father, we are reminded that we as believers in Christ Jesus are more than conquerors through him who loved us. And Father, we're reminded by the Apostle Paul in the book of Ephesians, I pray that out of his glorious riches, He may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your heart through faith. And I pray that you might be being rooted and established in love and have power together with all the Lord's holy people to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. We thank you, Lord, that you are on our side, and we praise you for our service together this morning. We give you thanks. Amen.